Majesty, when did you first become aware that you were going to be Queen of Denmark?
I became aware of that when I was about 13. It was the year in 1953, the year when they changed the constitution, and in conjunction with the constitution, also the law of succession. Up to that time, the law of succession had been the usual Salic law, where male succeeds to male, and where the female line does not have a chance. My first reaction, of course, was that, oh, but then my father won't be there, and that sort of thing. And they told me then not to worry, and gradually brought me up to the idea, and showed me that everybody was going to help me in this job too, and it was not a terrifying thing, but a great challenge.
In June 1973, Denmark's Queen and her husband, Prince Henrik, step ashore from the royal yacht at Thorshaven, capital of the Faroe Islands, on her first royal visit to her Faroese subjects since she came to the throne of Denmark in 1972. Many of the Danish monarch's hereditary titles, like King of the Wends and Goths, Duke of Schleswig, Holstein, Stormann, and of several other duchies, Margrethe has dropped. She is Queen of Denmark, Greenland, and the Faroe Islands. She is 34, university educated, and the mother of two sons. She is the 52nd sovereign in a line of unbroken succession which goes back to the days when there were Danish kings in England. According to the Faroese, their North Atlantic islands are the home of Western Europe's oldest parliament. Theirs is a disputed claim. But there is no doubt that today they welcome the reigning queen of the oldest monarchy in the Western world. The Danes are the latest of those modern kingdoms and republics which have submitted to a woman at the top. Margrethe is both a member of that exclusive club of monarchs with thrones and the trades union of female heads of state and government.
Det er i dag fjerde gang jeg er gået i land på Færøerne og har gjort den velkendte tur fra kajen op gennem gaderne til Lagtingshuset. Men det er første gang jeg kommer her som dronning og fra Lagtingets talerstol har mulighed for at henvende mig.
Having begun her speech in Danish, the Queen, fluent in six languages, ends her text in Faroese.
Som drottning eisini i forium, kjenjeg djupt orbild mig mina.
In the long history of the Danish monarchy, there have been only two reigning queens, both called Margrethe. The kings have been called either Frederick, like Margrethe's father, or Christian, her grandfather, who was king when she was born. On April the 9th, 1940, Denmark fell before Hitler's triumphant armies driving for Norway. Margrethe's birth, a week later, was the only sign of hope for dark days. During the German occupation, which the Danes now call the Five Evil Years, Margrethe's grandfather, King Christian X, stayed in Denmark. Mounted but alone, he was often seen in the streets of Copenhagen, the king's way of saying that Denmark still lived.
People used to follow him on foot or on bicycles and cheer, but it was just, there's the king. And while the king was on his horse, everything was well, so to speak. There's a story about some German officer asking, but how dare the king ride like that and without an escort and there's no policeman? And who looks after the king? And Copenhagen, somebody from Copenhagen saying, that's what we all do. We all look after him.
His son, King Frederick IX, who succeeded in 1947, was presented by his Queen Ingrid with three constitutional problems in the shapes of Margrethe and her two sisters. The king had no sons to succeed him as the constitution required. The people were consulted by referendum. They voted for a new constitution, signed by the king in 1953, making Margrethe his heir apparent. Aged 18, she was presented to the nation.
It was rather embarrassing to get suddenly to be so much in the public eye. And then, of course, it also brought it home to me that one day I wouldn't have my father. My parents were very wise, I think, because one of the things they said was that you mustn't think that it's for your own sake, because people don't know anything about what a child is like. You must imagine that what people would think is that your parents would be capable of bringing up the next person to be sovereign of Denmark. It seemed a very great thing to have to take on, and I wondered whether I would ever be capable. And, well, one has lots of doubts about one's own abilities at that age. At least, anyway, I did. But my parents have been a tremendous help to me all the time. They always seem to support me and to inspire me and to show me what to do and to tell me that it was a job like any other job in many ways. The difference between my job and the job of many other people was that I knew beforehand what it would be.
The education of the heir to the throne, here attending her matriculation ceremony at Copenhagen University, was tackled in a thorough Danish fashion. She was to study political science, law, sociology and philosophy at five universities, including Cambridge, where at Girton she was known as Miss Dane, Daisy to her family, and took a diploma in her chosen field, archaeology. She travelled to Egypt and with her grandfather, the eminent archaeologist King Gustav Adolf of Sweden, was joint sponsor of the Scandinavian expedition to preserve the temples of Abu Simbel. Inevitably, Princess Margrethe's tours became more social as she grew older, while the world's press, not to mention the mothers of the world's eligible bachelors, wondered who the future Queen of Denmark would marry. To a gossip columnist who asked, "When will your Royal Highness be finding a husband?" she replied, "Wouldn't it be fairer to ask, when will he be finding me?" The solution to these sentimental problems was provided by the third secretary of the French embassy in London, Count Henri de la Borde de Montpezat. The headlines made TV news around the world. A good-looking young Frenchman, who was not only a count but willing to learn Danish, had proposed to and been accepted by Princess Margrethe. Their wedding at Holman's Church in Copenhagen was on June the 10th, 1967. Princess Margrethe became Queen of Denmark on January the 14th, 1972, the day that her father, King Frederick IX, died. She took for her royal motto, "God's help, the love of the people, the strength of Denmark."
The actual succession happens in the historic moment when the old king dies and the new monarch takes over. It happens like that.
There was no coronation. Danish sovereigns are proclaimed to the people from Christiansborg Palace. The Prime Minister announced, "King Frederick is dead. Long live Queen Margrethe." For Princess Margrethe, the moment she had been waiting for with some dread has come. Her whole life had been a preparation for her job as Queen of Denmark.
I was supported from every side by my family and by the ministers, but so much also by the people. It was breathtaking. On that cold January day, and so many people on the square, I'd never imagined it would happen in our day.
One of the Queen's first public duties was to follow in procession behind her father's coffin through the streets of Copenhagen, past the crowds, to Roskilde, the tomb of Danish kings. The dead king and the reigning queen demonstrate the continuity of the monarchy, the oldest political institution known to Western man. Among the palaces and castles inherited by the Danish sovereign, Fredensborg is where Queen Margrethe feels most at home.
It was built in the first part of the 18th century by a king called Frederick IV. He built it partly because he loved this part of the country and partly to celebrate the peace between Denmark and Sweden, which he hoped would be final and which was final, and called the house Fredensborg, which means Castle of Peace. And I think the love that he felt for this house must have, one might even say, impregnated the house, because people have always lived here not for ostentation and not for grandeur, but simply because they loved it.
Mm-hmm.
Your Majesty, when did you first become aware that you were going to be Queen of Denmark?
I became aware of that when I was about 13. It was the year in 1953, the year when they changed the constitution, and in conjunction with the constitution, also the law of succession. Up to that time, the law of succession had been the usual Salic law, with the where male succeeds to male, and where the female line does not have a chance. My first reaction, of course, was that, oh, but then my father won't be there, and that sort of thing. And they told me then not to worry, and gradually brought me up to the idea, and showed me that everybody was going to help me in this job too, and it was not a terrifying thing, but a great challenge.
In June 1973, Denmark's Queen and her husband, Prince Henrik, step ashore from the royal yacht at Thorshavn, capital of the Faroe Islands, on her first royal visit to her Faroese subjects since she came to the throne of Denmark in 1972. Many of the Danish monarch's hereditary titles, like King of the Wends and Goths, Duke of Schleswig, Holstein, Stormann, and of several other duchies, Margrethe has dropped. She is Queen of Denmark, Greenland, and the Faroe Islands. She is 34, university educated, and the mother of two sons. She is the 52nd sovereign in a line of unbroken succession
in Denmark. It was made at the command of the king, and was probably intended as a present for the Empress Catherine the Great of Russia. It was painted directly from the color plates for a great volume on the flora of Denmark, the Danish wild plants. So you see, it has each plate and each piece of porcelain has a very exact drawing of a flower or a plant, exactly as they looked in the prints. And they were painted directly from the prints. They were very careful about it, and they put in the name in Latin, and even reference to the color plate in the book, which is rather amusing. And but it never, as you can see, never reached Russia because it's still here. Because the Empress had died before it was finished. I think they were 12 years in painting it. It was a very large dinner service. In its own day, it had more than 1,800 pieces. Then it was never made again for a very long time until in the second half of the 19th century, when some people decided that this would be the best wedding present for the then Princess Alexandra of Denmark, when she was to marry the Prince of Wales, later King Edward VII.
King Christian IX of Denmark, Margrethe's great-great-grandfather, commissioned this picture of his vast family, which covers the entire wall of a palatial room. They lived in the last grand era of European royalty. Queen Victoria described them as distinctly clannish. Now their regal countenances are only legend. But they tell us something of Fredensborg in its heyday, of Denmark's royal family, and of King Christian IX, four of whose children sat on European thrones, thereby earning for him his nickname, the father-in-law of all Europe. His daughter, Dalmar, married Tsar Alexander III. His grandsons, Christian and Prince Nicholas, the last Tsar of Russia. His sons, Frederick of Denmark and William, elected King George I of Greece. His daughter, Princess Alexandra, married Edward VII.
Edward VII is supposed to have been rather bored because there wasn't very much games played, and he's supposed to have grumbled a bit sometimes when he was pulled off to Fredensborg. Whether it's true, I don't even quite know. But it is the legend, of course. But there's a marvellous legend of three of these gentlemen walking in the park of Fredensborg, and they started to chat with somebody they met in the park. Anyway, this man didn't realize who he was talking to, and he asked, who are you? And one said, well, I'm a Prince of Wales. And the other one said, I'm the King of Greece. So the other said, I'm the Tsar of Russia. Ah, said he, I'm the Emperor of China.
The tradition of filming royalty at play is as strong as ever at Fredensborg. But the sense of distance from all ordinary life, characteristic of their Edwardian ancestors, so engrossed in their giddy pranks and yet so bored, has vanished. The Danish royal family, in their large, well-kept gardens, may seem a touch more lonely or aloof than other Danish families, but that is the limit of their exclusivity. Crown Prince Frederick, aged 5, seems unaware of his status or future responsibilities. Like his younger brother Joachim, he's more interested in play.
I, for my part, have spent most of my childhood here, ever since I was quite a small child, during spring and autumn. And coming back to it in my own right, so to speak, has been very strange, but very wonderful too, because it is a house I love, both for its atmosphere and for its beauty. I think I can say that it is our favorite house.
Prince Henrik of Denmark is as devoted to riding as is the British royal family, though perhaps he's rather less competitive about it. An all-round sportsman, he's happy out of doors and appreciates the freedom Fredensborg affords him.
I must say, I like very much Fredensborg. The surroundings are so nice, the country is beautiful. Fredensborg can ride a lot. I can take long walks and play tennis, sail also, because it's just 3 kilometers from the coast, so my boat is not far from there. We get much more privacy when we are not in town, and that's always a marvelous thing, to be out of the public eye.
Prince Henrik, with his diplomatic experience of courts and embassies, has no illusions at all about his role as Prince Consort.
First, I can describe that it's a very difficult job. As you know, it's why probably we are so few having that one. But no, because it ranges from all sorts of things. Our range of interest is so great that we have to give some time to each of the things that are interesting.
Do you find it, in fact, difficult, having been a private citizen and able to speak on topics, to be confined now in what you can say and what you can't say?
Yes, sometimes it's very difficult, but I think in another way it's an asset, because then you try to keep your mouth shut. It's like being an equilibrist on a tightrope, and you have always to be careful. That in itself is not so much, but for all the naughty boys who try to shake the rope in order to see you fall, and that is the danger in our job. No, but it's difficult also, because you always have to be in the shadow of your wife. People expect you to do a tremendous lot of things, but they never expect you to be responsible for what you do, because you have to be in the shadow of somebody else.
Prince Henrik does in fact do a tremendous lot of things. He is commissioner of the Danish Red Cross, president of Denmark's World Wildlife Fund, an honorary member of 19 organizations, patron of 27, chairman of the Danish National Committee for the European Architectural Heritage Year 1975, Today he's going to launch a ferry at the Baltic port of Nakskar. In the modest style of the Danish monarchy, their royal train is really only a royal carriage, which can be hitched on to any scheduled service. It travels free on the Danish system, but in other countries costs the equivalent of 20 first-class tickets a passenger mile. The ferry is to be christened the Prince Henrik after the consort, who in fact was christened Count Henri de Labord de Montpezat. When he married, he changed his French title and nationality to Danish, and his faith from Catholic to Lutheran, the Danish state religion. He has tried gallantly to speak the language like a Dane, but as he freely admits, it takes time to know another country.
Henrik skal være dit navn. Held og lykke til dig og dit mandskab.
Prince Henrik, in giving his name to a new ferry, keeps to the tradition of naming them after members of the royal family. For these ships and their royal namesakes unite the 500 islands and scattered communities of the kingdom. The Palace of Christiansborg in Copenhagen, site of the Supreme Court, the Foreign Ministry, the Danish Parliament, and the Audience Chambers. Here Her Majesty receives foreign ambassadors. So that none can boast or complain of curt or favoured treatment, each new ambassador goes through exactly the same ritual as the last, beginning with the Lord Chamberlain's announcement.
Majestæt, den overordnede befuldmægtigede ambassadør for New Zealand.
I have the honor to present to Your Majesty this letter from Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth II, accrediting me as the first New Zealand ambassador to Denmark. It will be my duty and my privilege to serve the interests of our two countries to the best of my ability. Your Majesty.
I welcome you very heartily, Mr. Ambassador. I'm very pleased to be able to receive the first ambassador from New Zealand.
Beneath the marble bust of an ancestor, Queen Margrethe and Prince Henrik chat with Ambassador Ian Stewart and his wife, a note of Danish informality after the rigours of protocol.
Basically agricultural country into a largely industrial country is still peopled by those with Danish names, although of course you wouldn't tell until you heard their name.
How amusing. Do they speak Danish still? Or?
I suspect that probably they don't. Perhaps some of the older people. Mm.
It's very funny because
the shops came out and helped to set it up. Yes, at the turn of the century. So there's a lot of close connections. Yeah.
Amalienborg Palace was originally built for noblemen, but since 1794 it's been the royal residence in Copenhagen. Here the Queen conducts the day-to-day business of the monarchy. Her office number is listed, like every other department of state, in the Copenhagen telephone directory, under Her Majesty the Queen, 143628.
Mellem mærket og starten på bysten, ikke?
Work starts at 9:30 a.m., with, on this particular morning, the proofs of the first stamps issued during her reign. The Postmaster General and the designer submit them for the Queen's approval. As the Queen is also an excellent draftsman and herself designed a special issue which proved very popular for Christmas 1970, she will take her own decisions about the precise colouring and design of these stamps. But such independence of action is unusual. On all subjects which touch upon the monarchy and the nation, the Queen will seek the counsel of her small and efficient court.
There's quite a number of people, but I think it's adequate and I think it's not excessive, which is also very important. I feel that it's very important both for the work done and for the way it looks seen from outside that the court should have the size necessary, but neither more nor less, so that things work.
Deres Majestæt på baggrund.
These people, they have, of course, attractive titles, but they have a lot of work to do. The principal court officer is the Lord Chamberlain, who is for the moment Count Knut, who is a former ambassador. And then he has the Master of Ceremonies. And these two are the chief officers of the court, I might call them. They run the full court finances, take care of our staff, both the house staff and the office staffs. They are also the connection through which the press get to know about what goes on. And they also obviously know quite a lot of what goes on in the country.
Det bliver ret mange, ja. Det var skriftsmand Frohn, og til sidst ambassadøren for Panama.
But the Queen's constitutional role is paramount.
That is a different office altogether, and that comes under somebody whose name is the Cabinet Secretary, if translated directly into English. What it means is he is my chief constitutional advisor, and also my chief legal advisor. And he comes with all the government papers to be signed. That is appointments and dismissals of various kind, which have to have the Queen's signature. He is, I think, perhaps the most important person for me as constitutionally as a queen, because he is the day-to-day connection with the government.
As head of state, the Queen, though she has no political power, is closely involved in the working of her government. In Denmark, where there is no cabinet system, all government ministers attend the Council of State once a fortnight. On government business, the Queen alone chairs the meeting of her ministers. None of her courtiers attend. The Queen in Council is entitled to full information, and following upon elections, calls the man to form a new government. The resolutions of Parliament are laid before the Queen. She will be expected to assent to all bills that have been passed, and she will not demur, though she may ask for an explanation. As constitutional monarch, the Queen is the only person present who is above all party loyalties or conflicts. Prime ministers may come and go. There have been three in Margrethe's as yet brief reign. But the Queen remains a symbol of national power, though she has none. A symbol of national unity, though 10 parties fought the last election. Above all, the Queen who reigns but does not rule is the servant of all her people. In Denmark, there are no investitures. Decorations and honours come through the letterbox. Twice a month, those of the Queen's subjects who have appeared in the honours list are expected to call at the palace to say thank you. Those honoured have their exact order of precedence recorded on a card index system, which puts them in their place socially. Social Democratic Party members are discouraged from accepting honours, but everybody else is pleased to uphold the custom and have an audience of the Queen.
It is, of course, the occasion when people who have received appointments signed by me, or people who have received orders and decorations, come and thank the sovereign for this. It is a tradition to come in tails or uniform, wearing whatever decoration you have been given, and also any others that you happen to have. And people are then ushered in one at a time to me, and I am completely alone with the person who comes, which is a very old tradition that the king should be accessible, and also that it should be possible for any citizen to speak in complete private with his king. Even today, when things are very far from the from those ancient times, I think it's of importance that the king is accessible.
Advance notices of the Queen's audiences are published in the press. Any Danish citizen can turn up and ask to see his queen. Some applicants are diverted to the ombudsman or other departments of state, though a group of Danish hippies from Nepal once got through bearing gifts. Essentially, the system is a characteristically Danish mix of formality and a personal touch.
I feel that formality and informality is a question of the occasion. One should never be so formal that one loses life, but one should never be so informal that that one becomes without form of any kind and shapeless, so to speak.
Do you in fact believe in protocol and etiquette?
I think that people imagine protocol and etiquette as a kind of, I don't know, some kind of great dragon that hovers behind the panels and the passages of the palaces to just pounce on you and eat you up if you aren't behaving as you should. But in fact, it's only, etiquette is also saying how to do when you meet people. Saying goodnight to your parents before you go to bed. Opening a door to a woman. Getting up so if an old person wants to sit down in the bus and it's all full. That is etiquette, or protocol, if you will, on the everyday level, the way we meet it all the time, all of us. And it is a way of etiquette and protocol is a way of knowing what you've got to do in the next second, so that you have your mind free to do other things and think of other things.
Do you have a royal freezing glance for certain occasions?
I don't know. Do you? Perhaps somebody who's received one would know. I don't know whether I have a royal freezing glance. I imagine most of us have some way of indicating that we've had enough.
To the astonishment of those who don't know Copenhagen or the tranquil good nature of the Danes, the Queen often goes shopping without a bodyguard. Nobody stops or stares. And in the midst of her own people, she takes her personal safety for granted.
Well, they're so used to seeing me that people sort of turn around and say, oh, there's the Queen, or they used to say, oh, there's Princess Margrethe. I don't feel that the sort of life comes to a full stop around me the moment I come into a shop or when I walk through the street, which is very pleasant to feel that one really belongs completely naturally in the picture.
Yeah.
If circumstances or fate had not decreed that Margrethe became Queen of Denmark, she would not have lacked a purpose in life or an occupation.
I might well have been an archaeologist. I was quite sure that I would have been an archaeologist. Today I imagine that I might equally well have been interested in something, some historical study which touches on things, so to speak. It might well have been history of art as well or something.
On September the 25th, 1973, Queen Margrethe and Prince Henrik arrive at the central station in Stockholm to be greeted by the young king, Carl Gustav of Sweden. The occasion is the funeral of his and Margrethe's grandfather, the much-loved King Gustav Adolf, who died in his 91st year. King Gustav won the devotion and respect of his people. It would not be too much to say that he prevented, or at least postponed, by his quality as a man and his popularity as a sovereign, the end of the monarchy in Sweden. The royals who walk in this procession may be witnessing the last really royal occasion in Sweden. A new constitution, effective in 1975, strips the king of his residual powers. Unlike his cousin, Queen Margrethe, he will not preside as king in council, and the Speaker of the Parliament will choose the man to form a government. The king becomes a figurehead. The death of kings, of a well-loved king, brings history to the surface of a city's life, as national pageant and in the kinship of the royal families of Europe. It is a spectacle without parallel, as well as the occasion of private grief.
It's a very old tradition, of course, that a king's funeral is not conducted in private. To many people it may seem both odd and cruel that the family have to go through that at that particular moment. But strangely enough, I think many of us in the royal families feel that we are never so well helped as at that moment. We don't have time to lapse into sentimental funeral feelings, which in a way I feel is a very healthy thing. Because when a very old man dies at 90 years old, it is selfishness to grieve. Complete selfishness. And this was a way of showing us all that by giving this old man this marvelous funeral, it was also thanking his memory for what he'd been and what he'd done, bringing us all together around this person whom we'd all love very much.
The twin spires of Roskilde Cathedral, 20 miles out of Copenhagen, stand sharp against the northern sky above the tombs of many Danish kings. Margrethe's father, Frederick IX, called the Sailor King, he was a master mariner, lies here in state. The Crown Prince Frederick and his brother Joachim come with Queen Margrethe to pay their respects before the king's coffin is entombed. When the Crown Prince succeeds, he will be King Frederick X of Denmark. Denmark's sovereigns have been buried here for over 1,000 years. The first church on this site was built in 960 by the first Christian king of Denmark. Here too is the tomb of Denmark's only other queen, Margrethe I, who reigned and ruled at the end of the 14th century.
This particular lady, Queen Margrethe, must have been a very remarkable woman. She had been brought up in Norway, and she must have been brought up to know to be able to reign in her own right. Well, she managed to unite the three Scandinavian countries of Denmark, Norway and Sweden in that order, being first the regent for her son of Denmark and of Norway, and then because of various complicated dynastic problems in Sweden, the Swedish noblemen asked her to take over the Swedish throne as well. She had the qualities of a politician, one might say. She had remarkable diplomatic abilities. She was able to make the noblemen of Denmark and Norway, the church, and all the different elements of her countries work with her. She was able to play them off against each other very cleverly.
Do you think that it would be more difficult to have been queen then than it is in fact to be queen now?
I think it probably each time and age has its own problems and complications, and of course the qualities demanded of a ruler in those days were completely different to what is demanded of anybody today.
Do you feel that the people of Denmark regard you as part of a very colourful and historic pageant, or do you feel that they think of you as having a practical and professional role to occupy in modern Denmark?
I think people have perhaps both a feeling of both things. I hope that is what people do feel, both things, because both things are part of the job that I'm doing. I feel that the monarchy, or my place is, or should be anyway, somehow be the rallying point of everybody. Something that in which one can, which we all feel this is where it all runs together. But also something where we feel that we're all part of each other.
Would you like to say why you believe that the idea of monarchy is a relevant one to the 1970s?
I would prefer to turn it round and say that as long as I'm doing my job as well as I can, and that as long as the best I can do is good enough, then it is relevant, then it will be relevant.
But what are the reasons, the intellectual arguments, for a monarchy as opposed to any other system of government or of heads of state in the world?
I believe a very important thing with monarchy is it's the continuity. It is, it carries on for, in our country it has carried on for a very, very long time, and so it has in many other countries.
But is continuity the prime reason that you would argue for if asked why have a queen?
It is a very important thing, I think, because it gives body to the idea of the country and to what people, we hope, feel they can look up to. It's not only the person personally, but it is also the person personally, which is important.
That is why you say that if you make a success of your job, then you can equally argue that monarchy is successful.
Yes, I think it is a thing that will, while it's there, when it works, it works.
The hallmarks of monarchy, grandeur, power, riches, mystery, the illusion of permanence, the outward splendor, are expressed in the castles and palaces of kings and princes. There are now more castles than the world's remaining monarchs can use, it's unlikely that more will be built. The Danish Parliament meets in Christiansborg Palace. For centuries the seat of royal power, it became the centre of parliamentary government after Frederick VII in 1849 accepted the inevitable and became Denmark's first constitutional monarch. Today the monarchy is very democratic. It's possible to say that in the referendum of 1953, the people selected if they didn't elect their sovereign, much as the Danes elected their kings before the period of absolute monarchy. Today, the monarchy is questioned by the press and parties of the left, who see even a constitutional monarch in a democracy as paradoxical and socially divisive. It seems that the Danes have no great love for monarchy as an idea, but great affection for their present monarch. The lack of any rational basis for hereditary kingship is argued by the Social Democrats, and it's a fact that a Gallup poll produced only 50% in favour of monarchy as an idea, but showed 90% of Danes in favour of the particular monarch they have at the moment, a paradox the Danes accept with serenity. As between the idea and the fact of monarchy, the rational Danes vote mainly for an egalitarian society and a welfare state. But they also pay £950,000 a year for the monarchy and loyally acclaim their queen. There seems no immediate risk of a republican mob storming Amalienborg Castle and turning it into a people's palace. It's a Danish royal tradition that on New Year's Day the monarch gives a banquet at Amalienborg for the members of her government and her administration. All the royal family, including the Queen Mother, Queen Ingrid, attend.
Min hjertelige nytårshilsen. Det er ikke blot årets første dag. Det er omtrent den første.
The Queen welcomes her guests on this New Year's Day of 1974 and her new government. There was an election in mid-December. The Queen's words are quite formal. But in this setting, surrounded by the men of power in her realm, the significance of the Queen's presence among them becomes clear, the function of royalty sharply defined. The new Prime Minister, Hartling, formed his government at the Queen's request. The Queen consulted all 10 of her party leaders before she summoned him. The sovereign obeys and upholds the constitution. The Queen does not rule, but while she reigns, she prevents unconstitutional change, or political power falling into the hands of less democratic men than those who come to her palace on New Year's Day.
It is an old tradition of exchanging good wishes on the new year. I am not quite sure quite for how long we've done it, but I'm fairly sure that it goes back well beyond 100 years. And this has traditionally been done by this dinner party or banquet, as we call it. All the government are there, the chiefs of the armed forces, and various other very high dignitaries. And I personally feel it as an occasion when we all meet and, so to speak, confirm each other in each other's roles. Accession, I took a motto in the way that the kings of Denmark have always done. My motto is God's help, the love of the people, the strength of Denmark. And my idea behind it was that, first of all, this job, this position as a queen of Denmark or of any country is impossible without the help of God. But that the love of the people is also the thing without which it would be meaningless. And that the strength of Denmark taken in a wide sense, not in a sense of power, but in every sense of integrity and well-being and health, is also the whole object of taking up such a position as I am. That is what I feel about it.
What would you like to be remembered for as Queen?
It's hard to say so early, with times changing the way they do today. I hope I will be able to be in tune with my times, but also that I will be a link to the past, because I'm quite sure that if one loses the link to the past, especially in these days, nowadays, when every kind of development is so quick, is so fast, I think one would lose one's roots, and I think that without roots, one is unhappy. Thank you. That I feel that is also a part of what monarchy is. It's also its roots. It should be, partly an embodiment of the history, but also an embodiment of the future, in some mysterious way.